I'm the chair. We'll have a roll call, please, of the town clerk.
Chairman Carson.
Here.
Council Berry.
Here.
Council Fritz.
Here.
Council McGinty.
Here.
Council Roberts.
Here.
Council Swift Kayata.
Here.
Council Robert, Watson.
Here.
Representative Bolus and Representative Rowe.
Yes, Representative Bolus is going to be a few minutes late from the student. Thank you. We have the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Reports and correspondence from councilors. This is looking good.
I just wanted to report that I, as a member of the Executive Committee, I attended the Council of Governments meeting on October 20th. It was a really interesting meeting. Mark Ayerman of Planning Decisions spoke on area development issues. And I have notes from that meeting. If anybody's interested, I can share them with them. Secondly, I want to make sure the public is aware that in the courier that is coming out next, there will be advertised openings on numerous town boards and commissions. The deadline for applications will be November 22nd, and I definitely would like to see a lot of wonderful candidates apply, so please don't be shy. It's a good way to serve the town. And that's it.
That's great. Thank you. Councilor Roberts.
Thank you very much. This past month has been a great month as far as trail work getting done in town. The Cape Elizabeth Land Trust had about 30 people down there, including a number of Boy Scouts, working on the runaway farm trails that they have. And then a week ago, the South Portland Cape Elizabeth Rotary Club had a large contingent of people down rehabbing the Great Pond Trail, refurbishing the boardwalk and building the bridge, cleaning out the trail, making it a little bit wider. And we had help from 8 young men from Cheverus who came over and served as the muscle power for getting the lumber down in there for us. And then this past Saturday, the sophomore class was going to have a trail day down at Broad Cove. And unfortunately, only two of the sophomores showed up, so I'm going to mention them by name, Nick Falk and Laura D'Angelo. Thank you very much for showing up. Maureen O'Meara came down, helped coordinate that. So we've had, three efforts within the past month. And I would like to encourage other people, if they have trails in their neighborhoods, to perhaps get together and try and work on those as a group. I mentioned to Dave Barber, I happened to see him the other day. Dave has been maintaining a trail at the over at the Poor Farm on the water side of by the marsh. And as a lot of people perhaps realize, I take care of the Levitt property behind my house. It doesn't take a great deal of work, but a lot of people really enjoy and appreciate the trails we have in town. We're extremely fortunate to have the amount of land that we do that is available. Thank you.
Well, myself and my two dogs enjoy your trails a lot, Jack, and I think of you each time when we walk on that moat area. Are there any more reports? Councilor Berry.
The Historic Preservation Committee had a public forum the other night, which was well attended. And we have a meeting of the Historic Preservation Study Committee on the 15th of November at 4 o'clock. And we hope to have a proposed ordinance for public response and reaction at a public forum on the 8th of December. So those are interested in that Historic Preservation Committee meeting. We look forward to you having you at 7 o'clock on December 8th, and that will be right here in the town hall. And before I leave the floor here, so to speak, I want to commend Cheryl Parker and her volunteers over at the Headlight. I attended a meeting that they had recently celebrating this wonderful year. They took in $92,796 in the month of October 1999, which has been a steady increase over the last 6 years or so. And I think they're to be commended for doing a wonderful job over there at the gift shop next to the Portland Headlight. Thank you, Madam Chair.
You're welcome, Councilor Beverly. That being all the reports and correspondence, the town manager's report.
Yeah, I just want to mention, first, follow up on what Councilor Berry just said, that
the event that he mentioned was a luncheon for the volunteers at, for Portland Headlight, and was held at DeMillo's. And I really want to commend Councilor Berry. He left before the lunch was served, so he did not simply go for the purpose of having lunch. So I want to commend him on that. Beyond that, I just want to thank the Department of Public Works for all their efforts on cleanup week. It went exceedingly well. Other councilors have mentioned some other projects that have gone along reasonably well this month. I have a memorandum that now running about 6 pages with everything that's been accomplished over the last 6 months that you'll be getting probably around the end of the week. And it's really been very, very busy, and I want to thank everyone for the cooperation. Did want to mention two other quick things, and that is that earlier this evening, the town council, in their capacity as trustees of the Thomas Jordan Trust, had a meeting at 7 o'clock to discuss the investment of some of the trust proceeds, and they voted unanimously to invest some of those in mutual funds as permitted by law, approximately 45% of the assets of the trust to be invested in mutual funds. Secondly, the town council will be having a workshop on November 17th here in this building, and there'll be two agenda items. The first is to receive the report of the Facilities 2000 Committee on the proposals relating to expansion, renovation, addition of fire and police facilities here in the center of town. And following that, there'll be a discussion following up with a meeting the town council had with representatives of the Maine State Parks regarding dogs on Crescent Beach, particularly on the beach itself. Finally, I do want to mention Andrew Rowe, sitting over here, our student representative. I don't know if any of you read the story about the state championship golf team, Cape Elizabeth High School, but Andrew is one of the stars of that team, and the entire team, as well as the women's soccer team, will be invited next month to be honored by the council. But Andrew, in particular, blushing over there ever so slightly, was one of the stars of the state championship golf team.
All right. What's his handicap?
Yeah, right. What is your handicap? Oh my
God. Six.
Six?
Sorry I asked.
You've got it. Whoa. Well, thank you very much. right at this time, this is an opportunity for citizens' discussion of items that are not listed on the written agenda. Are there any citizens out there that have items? Hearing none, we'll move on to the minutes of the October 13th meeting in 1999.
Madam
in the
Chair.
Packet.
I move that the minutes of the October 13th, 1999 meeting be approved as read.
Second.
Thank you. Is there any discussion, any errors or omissions anyone found? That being all those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Now, moving right on, item number 47. For our watching audience, item number 47 is a public hearing and action upon the proposed amendments to the comprehensive plan, the zoning ordinance, and the zoning map, providing for a new town farm zoning district covering the upland portion of the town farm of Spurwick Avenue. This is a public hearing. Are there any comments from the public? Yes, please go to the, thank you.
Tom Emery, 12 Juniper Lane. Excuse me, past chairman of the study committee and the technical report committee. I strongly encourage the council to endorse ordinance language to preserve the town farm property in perpetuity. Thank you.
Thank you, Tom. Any more comments from the audience? Yes.
Bob Danielson, 14 Reef Road. I, too, was on the Town Farm Study Committee, and I want to endorse the zoning district. It's my understanding that the Planning Department and the Zoning Ordinance Committee approved what we had drafted, I believe, in whole cloth. And I'm thrilled at that because we really tried to come up with a plan that would really make that area special. The one thing we were concerned about was development chipping away at that, or someone coming in with a proposal that sounded good at the time but over the long term would have had detrimental effects. In addition to that, there was easement language proposed. I'd ask the council to consider that at some point in the future. There's a tremendous amount of development happening around us right now. The next 10 to 20 years are going to be crucial. If something's not done, we may be in a very different situation in those 10 or 20 years later. I would recommend that the town council consider seriously putting some kind of restriction on that, even for a term of years, so that we don't have to deal with this every time a development issue comes up. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Are there any more comments from members of the audience? Seeing none, public hearing was closed, and we will now move to council discussion. Councilors. Councilor Barry.
Well, I was on the ordinance committee that reviewed this, and I wholeheartedly support it, and I think that Bob Danielson has said everything that I could say, but I hope that the council will adopt it.
Thank you. Councilor Roberts.
I've also served on that committee. Did everybody? I was going to try to propose an amendment, as several of the councilors are aware. We're trying to make the zoning ordinance be one that would require a supermajority, and a letter from our attorney indicates that that's something that we can't do, but I know that other communities do similar stuff to that, and I don't want to totally back away from that. I'd still like to, in the future, perhaps explore whether or not there is some way of doing that, even if it requires a charter change, that we could require either a 7-0 vote or a supermajority to change the zoning ordinance on both the town farm property and Fort Williams. But other than that, I support this wholeheartedly.
I think that those people, members of the council that have ideas like that can pursue them. I think it's absolutely vital and crucial that we adopt this now. And this can be independent of other things that may come at a later date, because
That's why I'm
your caution about moving on this to have really final, clear protection of the land. But I think it's important that we adopt this now.
That's why I said it would not be an amendment tonight, that I would, maybe something down the road we could explore further.
Right. Yes, Councilor Fritz.
Yeah, I very much support this ordinance as it's written, that goes this far anyway, in saying how this town farm property should be used in terms of ordinance language. I really think it's the highest priority land that we have, other than Fort Williams, I would say, because it preserves the views of the marsh and the sense of rural character that we have in our comprehensive plan, and the massive open space recreation that's available on this property. But I really think we need to adopt the three elements of this. But I would like to go further than that in terms of the easement that was proposed by the easement writing committee, and at least send it to workshop and talk about some way that we could have some more permanent protection on it, even if it's just for a length of time, if it isn't in perpetuity. So I will vote yes on all three of these items.
Hopefully this would safeguard this land until such time as we could. Mm-hmm. There would be maybe some further action. Three more comments. Councilor McGinty.
Jack, I did not serve on the committee. I obviously support this wholeheartedly also. I was disappointed that we were not given an option of a limited time easement. We were given an all or nothing type of proposition.
Yeah.
And I think that as a council, we backed away from that. And I hope that somebody will bring forward something that has a time limit on it, whatever that time may be, that we can safeguard that property for at least that period of time. And then a future council, of course, can take a look, whatever time that is, and see what the needs of the community are at that time. But I will support this ordinance.
Are there any more comments from the council? I would just like to make one comment to the committee that worked on this. Having served on and off over many years on the ordinance committee, a difficult job at best just to do the language. The fact that you could write this and get it passed by the ordinance committee word for word is really something, and I think it's a very difficult job that you've done, especially if you're not used to ordinances, and I really appreciate the time that you put into accomplishing this, and I hope that the next generations will certainly appreciate it. They certainly will when they see your land. I'm going to read these.
I want to make a brief comment that I should have mentioned under the town manager's report, but the only place I figure I can slide it in is this evening. What this is about is protecting a scenic view. it's protecting, you know, a resource that I think we now see as almost historic in Cape Elizabeth. And last Tuesday, the citizens of the state of Maine approved a constitutional amendment to the state of Maine constitution that gives the legislature the right to possibly give tax breaks for the protection of scenic views and historic properties. A lot of the details still need to be worked out. But that constitutional amendment came about really as the result of the efforts of a single person. And whether one agreed with it or disagreed with it, I think it's very important to note that a single citizen can have enough influence to work through the legislative process, to work with the press, to work with the citizens of Maine, to actually amend the Constitution of the state of Maine. And that citizen who worked with Senator Amaro, but the one who got it all started was Carol Fritz. And you know, no matter what one thinks on that, I just think it's amazing that she was able to accomplish that, and want to congratulate her on that achievement. So.
Good.
Flowers and telegrams will follow.
Well done.
I have to say I was pretty amazed in election night myself. But the amount of time that this town has spent on trying to work through the scenic assessment that says that this particular property is a priority in our town, and trying to single out some scenic views and having it in our comprehensive plan and it actually not getting approved, was part of my desire to get the scenic vistas part of that constitutional amendment. So thank you for your kind words.
Well, you did very
well. I would like to mention, though, the work that went into the background of this town farm proposal, the work of the Town Farm Property Study Committee, because that's a magnificent piece of work that documents what that land is really, why it's so important, and our motion that this would become part of the comprehensive plan. So if I could, I'd like to move adoption of the report of the Town Farm Property dated October 16, 1997 as a component of the comprehensive plan, and the adoption of the Town Farm District as an amendment to the zoning ordinance, and adoption of the Town Farm Zoning District, I'm sorry, adoption of the Town Farm District Zoning Map Amendment.
Second.
Oh, Henry, I think you didn't get there on time.
Well,
I think Councilor Roberts is not. It has been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
I think we should have buzzers.
All those in favor? Any opposed? Thank you very much, and thank you very much for coming. I hope that this fabulous piece of land can stay until somebody else can do some more work on it, if that's what you really feel should happen. But I think you've done an absolutely extraordinary job on this. And all the citizens, I speak for all the citizens when we give our appreciation to you and the amount of time that you've put into it.
Madam Chairman, would it is it possible to put on our next workshop meeting a discussion of the town farm easement proposal that was also part of that report?
Well, I think that there are two things at the next workshop that I think will take up our time, which is the 2000 Commission Committee and the state parks and the dog issue, which is something that many of us are interested in. And I don't know how to quite put a time limit on that, those two issues. And so I'm afraid that would be too much. But we certainly could, I think before we put it on a workshop, there needs to be something to come before to discuss. If it's just the easements as they were presented before, that would be something we could bring up again at the next meeting, but
yeah.
At another meeting.
I'd be happy to meet with the council chairman and the president of the land trust to see if we can draft something for consideration by the council that is of a limited time easement as has been suggested. And I have one in mind. I don't want to get into a debate this evening, but you know, if that is the desire of the council to at least have that before you for consideration, we can work with the town attorney to draft something.
But I don't think it's going to be done at the November 17th mm-hmm. meeting. We'll set a workshop for that once the manager gets something in writing. We can have a workshop, but without something to act on, to talk about. So I think that's any problem. All right, we're going to move on to item number 48, also a public hearing, is action upon the proposed revised appendices to the general assistance regulations. I'm going to ask the manager to comment on this before we open the public hearing.
I'm not sure if it's every year or every 2 years the Maine Department of Human Services looks at all the federal guidelines for allowances for general assistance. They then tell us these are the allowances you are required to adopt, and you know, unless you have your own regime of studies and et cetera, which there's only, I think, one city in the state of Maine that might do that, or at least they have done it from time to time. I don't know if they still do it anymore. But I would strongly urge these to be adopted. If anyone, before speaking from the public, wishes to have it all read as to what the allowances are, I'd be happy to do that.
Thank you. The public hearing is now open on this item. Are there any comments from the public? The hearing none. The public hearing is now closed. I'll entertain a motion from the council, so that we can then get into discussion.
Madam Chair, I move that we accept the proposed revisions to the appendices to the general assistance regulations.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? Hearing none. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Item number 49, consideration of a report from the Planning Board recommending proposed amendments to the comprehensive plan, the zoning ordinance, the zoning map relating to telecommunication facilities. Do you want to talk about this before we...
I can what? Do it very briefly.
Right.
Are you planning to do a presentation, Maureen? No?
Only if you want.
Well, just to... I sense there's not a whole lot of folks here discussion, so I'll just highlight it, and then Maureen can add to it if I say anything inappropriate or incorrect.
Even though Maureen.
The Federal Communications Act of 1996, I believe it was, mandated that municipalities throughout the United States provide facilities that would be necessary for wireless communication within their territories. Cape Elizabeth had a telecommunications task force that was chaired by Tom LaPrade, a member of the zoning board. It ultimately, they gave a report to the council. It was considered by the council. At that point, the report of that committee, there was much concern in some of the neighborhoods of Cape Elizabeth and in Shore Acres in particular, that one of the sites being proposed for a telecommunications tower site as part of that study was where the water tower is up off Avon Road. The town council, with concern and upon the recommendation of the planning board, concern over that recommendation, asked for a study to be done, and we commissioned a firm called Flack and Kurtz to look at alternative locations, to look at how we could possibly meet this mandate, as well as put towers in a place that were somewhat agreeable to the community. The planning board received that report, had a workshop with the council. We also hired Oast Associates to look at the transfer station property to see if, once we found out from Flack and Kurtz that that would work up in the air as far as sending the signal, would it work on the ground as far as physically placing a tower there, with both geotechnical with DEP issues as well as setback issues. They found that that would work, and there's a study elsewhere on your agenda this evening that submits that. Anyway, the planning board is recommending a whole host of amendments governing towers, but primarily I think the major issue that's garnered public attention is where would they be, and the two locations are the High Hill that's off Spurwink Avenue and back of Bill Jordan's farm on land currently owned by Herb Strout, as well as the transfer station site owned by the town of Cape Elizabeth. Maureen is here to answer the detailed technical questions in terms of megahertz and signal capacities and the rest of it. I can't answer those, she can.
I'd like to make it clear to the public who are watching this, at this time the council is not going to act on any of these items as listed, but we will be sending it on to the council's ordinance committee. And when it comes back, would then be an appropriate time. The material is always available in the town hall for people if they're interested to hear what it says. And you certainly may come to all meetings of the ordinance committee of the town council if you're particularly interested.
It's also posted on the town website, the proposed ordinance language, as well as the amendment to the comprehensive plan, the language, at www.capeelizabeth, it being one word, .com.
Oh, we're into the 21st
century. One of these meetings, you're going to see it right across the front of the podium.
Fine. I'll entertain a motion from the council. Councilor McGinty.
Madam Chair, I move that we send the telecommunications zoning amendment to the ordinance committee for appropriate action.
I'll second that because I'm on the ordinance committee.
Okay. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you very much. My, we're here at this item. Item number 50, consideration of a report from the Enhanced 911 Addressing Committee recommending revised street names within the community. I'm going to ask the manager to give a little synopsis of what's been going on for a moment first.
Yes, I'm very pleased to bring this report from the Addressing Committee. The Addressing Committee is chaired by the Addressing Officer, I think is the title, who is by ordinance the Chief of Police, David W. Pickering. We also have an Addressing something or other title, I forget what it is, Coordinator Bob Conzel, the Town Tax Assessor, who serves on the committee, as well as Phil McGuldrick, the Fire Chief. They have worked extensively, probably meeting about 20 times over the last 6 months to work these issues through in terms of complying with the new addressing ordinance that was adopted earlier in the year by the council and following the addressing guidelines of the State of Maine Department of Public Safety. What you have before you this evening are not the revised street numbers, because the addressing ordinance that you enacted earlier provided that this committee was to resolve those issues. But the names of different roads and what's proposed. There's been a strong bias throughout this process to change as few names as possible, one, and two, to work as openly, as publicly, with public participation as possible. To that end, the committee has had a public forum at which many people attended. They've sent pre-letters out, they've given opportunities for folks to respond, and they've made many, many changes as a result of the citizen input. I'm not going to go into any of those, but they're on your list, and there's also a synopsis. So it's been an extensive public process. In addition, just since your report came to you last week, there's three more changes that they've made and suggestions to citizen comments, all of which have been run by the people on the streets. I would caution the town council. I gave you an article. My good friend Duncan Ballantyne, the city manager of Concord, New Hampshire, it was featured in Governing Magazine. And I guess this issue really blew up in the city of Concord, New Hampshire. And, you know, if there are citizen comments on this, you know, I think the danger for the council to try to change a single one from the podium, you know, could bring on another Concord, New Hampshire, which is I'm not sure that's what you'd want. But if any citizens do have comments, you know, they ought to share them this evening. And I'd suggest that, you know, for those particular streets, maybe you put them off and have them go back to the committee without saying, yes, that should be it, or no, it shouldn't be it. You know, I think if you open the Pandora's box, you also risk that, you know, you may not know all of the different issues that went into the naming of a road, all the different folks that were consulted, and the fact that just one person who stands up here this evening who may want something changed, it might be opposed by two or three others on the street. They've really tried to work out those issues, and I commend them for that. It is ready for adoption, and the reason why it's encouraged to be adopted this evening is the fact that many of the citizens of Cape Elizabeth, between now and your next meeting, will be preparing holiday cards and messages. I've already received two this week, surprisingly. And that's a real good opportunity for folks to indicate that your addresses would likely be changing on March 1, would be changing on March 1. So that's why there's encouragement to adopt this evening. So with that, the Chief Pickering is here to update you on the process and the changes that have been made.
Thank you. I think the manager's done a nice job of encapsulating what we've been doing over the last several months, actually. I did want the council to have the benefit of the figures that we've considered over the last few months. Since we met with you, I think in August, as Mike mentioned, we did have a public meeting, which was very well attended, very well received. And as chairman of the committee and on behalf of the committee, I think that the public deserves a lot of consideration here as well, because they've done a great job in assisting us in working through a lot of these issues. I think they've been basically supportive of this entire project. Even though they know it's going to be inconvenient for them for a period of time, I think they realize what we're trying to do here. So the support from the public has been excellent, and we really couldn't have done this project without their concerns and their input, so we certainly appreciate that. When we first put this out and asked for reconsideration requests, we asked that they be put in writing so we could have some semblance of order to it. We originally got 98 written requests for reconsideration. That evolved into 178. This thing kind of takes on a life of its own, and we found that many people were writing on behalf of the street or a particular neighborhood. In fact, we had two letters which generated concerns from about 54 different residences. So we looked at 178 specific requests for reconsideration. Of those, 29 were allowed to keep their existing address, both name and number. They had made a particular case to us. We took a look at it. Sometimes we had to mitigate that request by asking for specific signage or for directional signage. In some instances, we advised them that they could keep their existing street number and name, but if they developed a certain lot that was adjacent to that property or something that would require a name change in the future. Of the 178 requests we got, 46 presented us with alternative names or addresses or street numbers, and we agreed to them, so that was 25% of all the requests for reconsideration we got. We had six individuals that had not been originally earmarked for change, but because somebody on the street had called us or notified us that they thought that a change was in order or there had been a particular issue in that particular neighborhood, we ended up changing their addresses. So only six were, you know, surprised by a later change of address. We had 54 people that were denied reconsideration, and most of those were for street number changes. We met with one individual specifically that represented a group of 22. We had another individual that wrote on behalf of about 30 residences in the southern end of town, and we just couldn't find any kind of middle ground. And both of those situations were what we consider to be quite dangerous in terms of how they have been numbered in the past. So 30% of the requests for reconsideration were denied on the part of the committee. We had 43 that we'd asked for changes originally. We had to change those again because, again, somebody on the road might have proposed a different name or a different number. So as you can see, this thing kind of feeds on itself, and every time we have to make a concern for somebody on the street, we have to consider everybody else in the neighborhood that's going to be affected by it. So all in all, it's been a fairly lengthy process. I think we've been very responsive to the citizens. We've gotten a number of calls and a number of letters, as I mentioned, that said, you know, that they were glad that this was happening. We even had people from various streets that said, gee, we're surprised you didn't change our street, and we're constantly having a problem as far as deliveries, et cetera, going to wrong addresses. And in those instances, we would take a look at those street addresses and, in fact, did change some of those. So you have the names in front of you, as I said. The entire committee is here and ready to answer any questions you might have.
Thank you very much, Chief Pickering. I would like to caution those in the audience that this is not a public hearing and that we may not make changes, as the manager has cautioned us not to, by comments that are here, but it's not to say that that cannot be, your discussion cannot be re-looked at. Is there anybody here who came specifically to talk about the 911 enhanced roads? Thank you very much. Good. Now, Council. Councilor Roberts.
Question to the Chief, if I might. I'd received a couple of letters, Chief, regarding how the town could go about naming private drives, and I've gotten my answer, but can you state it publicly so that people realize how we are doing that or why the committee is making those changes and what the authorization is?
The town, at the request of the state, adopted an ordinance last year.
Yeah.
Which allowed us to name these private streets. The protocol for that, or the standard, is that any street that has two houses or more on it, or the opportunity for two or more upon build-out, for instance, they had 50 feet of frontage on a particular street, is supposed to be named specifically, other than the existing street that the road fronts on. So that was a recommendation by the state, and again, it was in consideration that this land is going to be developed at some point in time. That was the other issue we had with this particular project, is you got to think 100 years ahead, you know, what could be there down the road. So that again, was a state recommendation. It was approved by ordinance by this council a year ago, and that's why we can do that.
Thank you.
Chief Pickering, could you, before we go on with questions, could you explain the three changes that came here tonight that is not in our packet? There are three changes that came from someplace that did not get printed in our packet.
Okay.
Just for our information.
Some of these requests were not responded to until the last week or so. Some property owners lived out of state. We got a couple of our notifications back that we had a wrong address, and we had to do some research to find a new address for them. So most of the ones that you see that were not originally in the packet, we just worked on today, and that's why they were included as an addendum.
Do we have them?
Yeah.
They're here. We don't have them. I knew there was three changes.
I'll explain what they
So that's why I wanted you to explain, because we didn't have them.
You explain what they are.
We have two separate packets here of listings. My packet here, they are arranged according to the New Street name. That is an identical packet. Those are arranged according to the Old Street name.
The three streets are? It's the Robinson one, the Manawar one, and the, I don't know what the third one is.
Oh, yes. Several of them were off Old Ocean House Road. Victoria Pool, Barker Pool, that area down there, which we're calling Boat Cove Road.
Call what?
Boat Cove Road.
What was the other road?
Robinson Cove Road, Offshore Road.
Right.
Man of War.
Man of Law. Yes, that was my road. It was proposed by my neighbor, Greg Powell. Is going to be Golden Ridge Road.
It's called what, Chief Brigham?
Golden Ridge Road.
Oh. Was he talking about Man of Law?
That's what it was originally. I thought it was cute.
I thought that, since the chief lived on it, that was it. Okay. All right. Does everyone understand the three changes that were not listed in here? Councilor Fritz.
Golden Ridge Road.
I had a question in my own neighborhood where the neighborhood requested change in the number, and I think individual property owners have received letters saying that the numbers, it's single-digit numbers are being used.
Right.
But they're double-digit in here. They're the original numbers that were proposed.
They shouldn't have been. I thought we checked the bottom. It might not have been into the database, Carol. They should have received the notification that they were single numbers.
Yeah.
The database you see there is not the one that I used. Bob has been using that from all 3,600 addresses in town. The database that I created at my office dealt with just those individuals that asked for reconsideration, so that might not have been modified yet, but your neighbor should have been notified of the correct addresses and single-digit addresses, because I remember specifically they requested that.
I was just concerned about adopting this that was incorrect in the list.
The council would only be adopting street names and not numbers.
Right.
I understand that.
Councilor Barry.
I had a couple of questions. Why is Lydon Lane changed to Lydon Lane East? Is there a west?
There's actually two ends of Lydon Lane, and there's kind of a no man's land in the middle.
I see.
We had proposed to name that middle section, and the Lydon family requested that that name be kept in perpetuity. So one way to mitigate that was to create Lydon Lane East and Lydon Lane West.
I see.
We were also advised that center section might be built out in the next 18 months is what was proposed to us. At that time, it would all be called Lydon Lane.
And on Woodland Road, I thought I was driving up Beacon Street in Boston. You've got Arlington, Berkeley, Clarendon, Dartmouth, Exeter, Fairfield. What's the reason for that?
That's all Woodland Self Apartments, and those are unit designations for Woodland Self Apartments.
I see. All right. Thank you.
Councilor McGinty.
What's the total number of name changes?
Total number of name changes is about 350. There were 700 total address changes, and about half of them were street numbers and about half of them were street names.
Half of the 300 were numbers and half?
Half of the 700.
Half of the 700 were numbers. Councilor McGinty.
How much has changed the names of the signs?
I don't know.
Bob knows.
How much to change the names per sign?
Yeah, per sign. I mean, how much is it going to cost us to change all these street signs?
Chief, there's 350 addresses that are getting new street names, but there aren't 350 new street
names.
That's
right. There's probably only around 50, maybe even less than that, 40 or 50 streets that are going to be changed. We also have had requests for private way signs, which I think we've suggested we would provide as well for those private streets.
Is that all right, Councilman?
About 50 street name signs, Bob.
Just a ball.
He's a...
$50 a piece.
He probably knows what he's got, too.
No.
Just this. Some of them don't have holes. They pull this out of my hand.
Sorry, Bob.
You're probably looking at about, for materials to put the signs up, $25 to $35 per sign in that neighborhood.
Thank you.
On that same topic, we've gotten several requests. In fact, we got one today that asked that the typical street sign not be erected at the end of their street because they felt it would look more like a public street, even though it had a private way sign. They thought it would encourage traffic down into a private way, and they were asking if they could erect their own street signs. And we've had several requests for that. We haven't discouraged that practice so long as it meets our standard in terms of the size and it's on contrasting background. So we may have several of those that are erected by the property owners.
Okay.
Any more discussion from councilors? Councilor Fritz.
Are you still meeting with people who have some disputes over numbers?
We're hoping that this is 99% complete. We would not reconsider an address change at this point that hadn't already been appealed, unless it was some, you know, we'd made a mistake, which is entirely possible considering the amount of addresses that we looked at. But hopefully we may have a few revisit items for you in December, but that's, again, something that an individual just notified by about last week or so.
Any other comments from Councilor McGinty?
I'm very uncomfortable with changing the addresses of 350 homes in town without even holding a public hearing. I mean, it's no reflection on the committee. They did their job. I think this is overkill. I think it's going to turn into a nightmare. A lot of these locations, Old Ocean House Road, for instance, I mean, we know where that is now, but now we're going to have people running around trying to find, Boat Cove Lane and other streets, other names have been assigned to these streets. And, I read the article too, but I think it's going to turn into a nightmare, quite honestly. And I think it's overkill. And again, I don't know how we can adopt this. I guess we can legally, but without even having a public hearing. I'm uncomfortable with that.
I guess the public hearing is that every household was notified in the town, and every household had an opportunity to go through a process by calling the committee, listening, making suggestions. Everybody sat down to consider the suggestions, and it was mitigated and worked out. That's probably the best public hearing that you could have, because people speaking here on individual numbers of streets would have a lot more difficulty getting a change or getting themselves heard. I think I would call that the public hearing, in a sense. There was a public forum here. There was a good turnout. People came. They made comments. I thought the chief made a terrific presentation at that particular evening. I certainly believe wholeheartedly in having a public hearing when it is necessary, but I think that we have really had the public hearing at this point, considering that every household has gotten a letter in their house at their door. But that would, it's, and I know we're talking about 350 changes in the community, and that people have to learn where those roads are. I've lived here all my life, and every year there's a new road with three houses on it, and I have no idea where it is. I see them in the reports that we get from the town, and I have to ask somebody, where's that road? It's not here. There are new roads all the time. These new names will be like having a new road. We'll have to learn where some of these are, but I certainly leave it up to the council to make a decision here. Councilor McGinty.
I just think that one day people are going to wake up and find out that they don't live on their same street, and I think we're going to hear about this, and maybe we're not hearing about it now, and I agree with everything you said about the, the vetting of these names through the committee and all that, I'm surprised, really kind of surprised that the people are so compliant with this and aren't fighting it harder, that only 178 requests came in for changes. I would have thought that everybody would have been fighting to keep
right.
their address. I mean, there's certain ones that are obvious that need to be changed, and I have no problem with that. Hillcrest, for instance, that's an obvious one. Maybe I'll be wrong, but I think that people are going to be upset one morning when they wake up and don't live on the same street anymore.
Chief Pickering, in what way of the streets that got changed, were those houses then notified? I mean, They were notified in the beginning that there was going to be the possibility of changing, and people had the opportunity. Now the decision has been made to actually change their road. Have they been notified that the change has actually taken place?
Well, everybody that was published in the paper, they also got an individual mailing. We have not notified them that this is absolute at this point. We're waiting for council action to do that. These changes would not take effect until March, so there's a lot of opportunity for other publicity about that as well.
Chief, there was a follow-up letter. You sent one letter saying it's going to be changed.
Right.
After your committee met and said yes or no, you did send a follow-up letter.
Oh, absolutely.
Oh, that's what I'm looking for. So
yeah, for those individuals that asked for reconsideration, they've all received a response. Whether we agree to them or not, the numbers that I read to you was in response to that, those 178 requests for reconsideration.
But
the fire chief just reminded me of a good point, is that many of the roads were created. You know, for instance, my road did not have a street name. So any place that you saw a driveway with two or more houses, which all, would normally have used the intersecting street, that was a new road change. So we didn't change very many, like the Orchard Road, we had to change, things like that. But as far as existing street names, we didn't change so many of those. And I don't have that breakdown. I don't know how many new roads were created, but I'd say a significant portion, 20% maybe, 25%, something like that.
The major one was probably Kettle Cove Road.
Kettle Cove Road, and we did not receive one call from Kettle Cove.
Well, I'm sure everybody that lives in the road is happy to have the name Kettle Cove Road.
As a matter of fact, one person did write and say that they were thrilled with Kettle Cove.
Yeah. Yes, Councilor Barry?
This is a state requirement in order to get the 911 that any place with two either houses or developable lots has to have a name. Is that correct?
It is a state-recommended protocol.
State-recommended, but not stringently enforced? Or
yes, I won't go to prison if this is not adopted.
Well, I think we'll all find that a comfort.
However, for the 911 system to work as efficiently as it's capable of doing, this system needs to be in place, and that's why they're recommending these specific protocols.
I'm sure the citizens, when this goes into effect, will be happy to have the 911. I know that oftentimes citizens call 911, and I know it's picked up in South Portland, and that becomes a problem for people. So in the end, it will be the best time for us community, but I know it's difficult now for people who do have some changes. I will entertain a motion from the councilor or any more discussion.
Madam Chair, I just wanted to say that I have some of the same concerns that John has about some of the names that would appear to be able to stand alone. But at the same time, I understand this isn't a perfect science. And for every one that we change or incorrectly, you know, there's one that maybe we miss. So, you know, I'm going to support this change, but I also think that, John, you make some valid points that, you know, I think we need to be sensitive to the fact that this isn't a perfect science, and we may have some people who somehow miss the notifications and aren't happy, but if we can save a life here or there as a result of this non-perfect science, I think, you know, we need to adopt it. But also at the same time be somewhat flexible as we go down the road to look at anything that's, you know, a real egregious mistake that we've made here, that we can revisit that at some point. I think we need to have some flexibility here, that if we've missed something in this huge process that you folks have all undertaken, and I understand that it's, you know, a tremendous process that you've gone through, I think there needs to be a process and something in place that allows it to be revisited without having to you know, get something through Congress to have that happen.
Fine. Now, is there any more discussion? I'll entertain a motion.
I'd like to move.
Has it been moved? It wasn't moved. You just moved it?
I just moved it.
You have to be fast.
I was trying. I was trying.
Second it, Ann?
I'll second it.
Fine. It's been moved and seconded that we accept the enhanced 911 addressing committee recommendation for street names within the community. All those in favor? Opposed? Councilor McGinty is opposed. Now, Councilor McGinty, we had this thing at the cemetery where you insisted that we do that road over again because somebody from the cemetery might call 911.
There are obvious ones that need to be changed. I said that, but I think that this has gone
but
too far.
But the cemetery was not very obvious.
They couldn't complain at the cemetery. They couldn't complain to him at the cemetery.
So I point out that my address has been changed 3 times during the time I've lived at my home. But
so has it? Really?
You adjust.
All right. Thank you very much. And I know it has been a tedious job for you guys, and I appreciate the time that you put in. And I'm sure that there will be some opportunity that other citizens will be calling in who didn't, as you say, didn't hear or didn't really understand. And I know that we will be flexible in that. But we haven't got much time to be flexible, I know. These signs will be getting ready, and March is the date. When does 911 actually begin in Cape Elizabeth?
We've been told by the state that their cutover date is scheduled sometime July or August. And they're actually working in York County and working this way. And as I understand it, a PSAP takes about 2 weeks to go online from the time their engineers land on site. So it's a very involved, highly technical process, apparently. So we're looking for sometime this summer.
Fine. Thank you. Item number 51, consideration of a report from the Planning Board recommending changes to the zoning ordinance that would change the, quote, undue hardship, unquote, variance standard with a, quote, practical difficulty, unquote, variance standard. Any discussion from the council? Councilor Barry.
I do not approve of this change. I think that practical difficulty is a softening of the zoning ordinance, and the standard has always been hardship, and the decided cases seem to support hardship as the standard. Mm-hmm. And I think to weaken the standard is to weaken the zoning ordinance, and I think that the hardship can be interpreted by the boards who administer this. And the question as to whether there is undue hardship can be decided by the board without changing the language of the ordinance. And so I am not in favor of this change.
Well, Councilor Barry, I will say it's recommended that the council send this on to the ordinance committee this evening. And your responsibility then is to convince the other two members of the ordinance committee to make a recommendation to the full council.
I shall accept the stimulating challenge, Madam Chair.
Councilor McGinty.
I move that we send this to the ordinance committee for appropriate action.
It's been moved and seconded. This item be sent to the ordinance committee, and the council will expect a report back if there's no death between now and then from somebody who doesn't agree, right? any further discussion?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
For the purposes of people at home, could we have a definition of undue hardship versus practical difficulty? If I have read this information correctly, practical difficulty is referred to as the ability of a petitioner to pursue a use permitted in the zoning district in which the property is located and result in significant economic injury to the petitioner. But how do we define undue hardship?
Henry, do you know how to define undue hardship from your time on the ordinance committee?
Maureen does.
Maureen, this is for the benefit of the people watching. This is the town planner, Maureen O'Meara, who hopefully will shed some light on this.
You want just a general definition?
Yeah, just a very general, in comparison to the...
The comparison is, and I need to make sure you understand, this is a recommendation that has been, it's the child of the zoning board. But the undue hardship criteria basically says that you are granted no relief from the zoning ordinance unless there is no economic value in your property without the variance. So it's extremely difficult to meet that standard with a straight face in the town of Cape Elizabeth. If you own a home and you bought the home and now you want to add a bedroom, and you basically have to show that there's no value in the property. And the zoning board's problem is that they are seeing a lot of proposals, especially on non-conforming lots, for requests for a variance so that they can do things to their home that the zoning board feels make sense. The neighbors don't object. It adds value to the property, it allows people to stay in their home, but if they strictly adhere to the standard in the ordinance, they must deny it. So they've struggled mightily with this. They've winked at the ordinance, probably, and approved some things that maybe didn't quite meet that standard. They have, in the last couple of months, started denying things. And the planning board, for I think the first time that I can remember, actually had two people come to the public hearing and speak in favor of this amendment, which I don't think we've ever had anyone do that before. But that's the difference. Practical difficulty is a little more lenient. It says that there's going to be some, you don't have to lose all financial value in the property in order to get the variance.
So basically what Councillor Berry is saying is that it is, does soften the existing zoning.
It's going to make it, yes. If you go from a undue hardship to a practical difficulty standard, you're probably going to be able to legitimately grant more variances.
Okay. Thank you.
I'll entertain a motion if there's no more discussion on this item. There is a motion on the floor? Thank you. They're hearing no more discussion. All those in favor? Opposed? You're opposed to sending it on to the ordinance committee? Okay. Just trying to be sure we were talking about the same thing. Item number 52, consideration of a study indicating the feasibility of a telecommunications tower near Cape Elizabeth Transfer Station. Mike, do you want to respond to this, or I know what your recommendation is in here.
Yeah, I would, since this study indicates that a tower may be placed there at a cost of a little less than $150,000, I think it ought to be really referred back to the town manager, because there isn't any ordinance in place yet that would allow a tower. You got that report earlier this evening and referred it to the ordinance committee. So what I'd like to do is look at this, see what potential there is for private sector participation and the cost of it, and then ultimately come back to you with a report concurrent or after you receive, you enact an ordinance that would actually allow a tower on this location. It makes no sense to develop it until there's actually permission.
It's appropriate for the council, then, that being the case, to vote to receive the report at this time.
So moved. Second.
I'm not sorry. I'm sorry I didn't hear, but I hope the town clerk did hear that exactly who moved and who seconded this motion. Any more discussion? No.
Yeah, I just wanted to thank Ost Associates for a very detailed report.
It certainly is a detailed report. And there are many citizens who are happy to hear that, so it is not in their backyard, I'm sure. Any more discussion? Did the motion say the vote to receive? What did the motion say? Okay, thank you.
Refer to the minutes.
All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Well, consideration and possible award of the bids received for improvements to the Gulfcrest property. This was a long-awaited bid process that the town has been waiting for. I practically came over at 2 o'clock to hear them myself, but I'm going to give the manager an opportunity to respond to this.
Yes. This was placed out in competitive bid, advertised in the newspaper. What it would do is accomplish the construction of a new public works garage. It would also permit the construction of two multi-purpose athletic fields, one of which would be football size, and the other would be sufficient for soccer, lacrosse, field hockey, and the balance of those types of sports. The low bid came in at $2,920,000. That includes the base bid plus two alternates. The two alternates include a athletic equipment storage building, and we were fortunate that the low bid alternate bid was also the low bidder on the overall project, which shows that is a good price. That we have a real problem with storage of athletic equipment. And the second alternate is for the pump station and the sewer pipe to hook up the transfer station to the sewer system for this building. Because this also entails having this building on sewer and bringing the sewer down Spurwink Avenue to the pump station on Spurwink Avenue. Extremely pleased when we received, I think it was back in February, the estimate from Ost Associates as to what this project was going to cost, the bid portion. They came out a little over $3 million. And last week, it seemed like every day I picked up the newspaper, it was some town, a state agency, a school district complaining that they didn't know what to do with their bids, and we came in actually $100,000 less than the OST estimate. You asked, well, why is it overall $3.6 million that I'm looking for and not $3.5 million? There are basically two changes, really three, to what we were looking at in February. One is that I have proposed an increase in the construction monitoring of about $40,000. One problem I found with the pool project is that the contract with Harriman Associates provided they were only had to be on site about once a month, which, you know, they weren't coming to the weekly construction meetings, and as a result, I think early on the contractor didn't get answers to their questions as soon as they should have in order to move the project along quickly. Because this is really a detailed project and it is for a set duration, I really believe it's in the town's long-term best interest to increase the construction monitoring so that it's about 4.5 days a week on average, assuming a six-month construction period. The second change is the construction in contingency. I have it 7% rather than at 5%. I generally, in Cape Elizabeth, prefer 7, don't know, can't always afford it, but that adds up to $204,000. Third, I had asked Bob Malley before the bids came in, this wasn't a wish list that he put together after the money came in, I asked him before the bids came in to develop the budget for furnishings. You have a list here, and this includes everything from team benches to football goalposts, two at a total of $2,600, for instance, property markers so that we don't have people trespassing onto adjacent properties, a refrigerator, a microwave, a television, you name it, it's on this list. And I think what's really good about this is that, you know, we're not buying ourselves expenses in the future. We're paying for things up front and identifying the cost. So that adds up to a total of $3.6 million. The bond proceeds was $3.5 million. We will get, Bruce Cogswell had estimated our bond counsel when he did an arbitrage calculation to be taking in $120,000 in interest earnings. We are in the process of putting that money out to bid. It'll probably be slightly less than that. But well, I think with the contingency we have, we're right there at the $3.6 million. We have reviewed, or we, meaning OST Associates, have reviewed the experience of Keeley Construction, checking it out with many of their recent projects they've done. I think there's a report before you on the council podium this evening indicating that the references checked out well. They have been in business since 1977. And they've done a lot of, you know, good-sized projects of late, including a new Holiday Inn Express that folks can see is down in Saco, just off that exit as one example. They've done an awful lot of work for People's Heritage Bank and also St. Maximilian Colby Church. Any of you have been to that over in Scarborough, you can see it's a, you know, a very quality job. So I enthusiastically and very pleased, and as I mentioned in the memo, relieved to be recommending the award to Keeley Construction. If awarded this contract, I have an appointment at 12 noon tomorrow, along with Bob and Javi Ost, to get the contract signed, and they plan to begin work in the next couple of weeks. So it looks very positive. So thank you.
Councilor Fritz.
The list that we got of the...
Bob's list?
Right, the fixtures budget. And for the facility and the recreation complex. I'm just wondering, if we approve that list, is that the list we get, every item on there?
No, what you're approving is $166,000. My thought is that some of this will come in less, a little bit may come in more. You know, what I do was work with Bob and with Steve Harding and Joe Hennessy of the engineering firm to make sure that these types of things stay within that $166,000. There will be some elasticity. But obviously, the things we know we need, the football goalposts, the soccer goals, the lacrosse, the time clock, you know, yeah, we'll be getting all those. But these are estimates, and there may be some savings in some of them. But these are a result of Bob making a lot of phone calls.
I guess my concern is that the football goalposts in there, and we really have had a policy discussion on whether we're funding football in Cape Elizabeth. The school budget isn't funding it. You know, I think we have adequate sports in the town, and we really haven't gone with that decision and looked at the entire cost of funding a football program. So it seems to me that inappropriate to be in here when we haven't looked at the whole picture.
We included that based on two things. One was the town council review request a year ago to use the field at Fort Williams for football, for practice. The council approved that request, understanding that it wasn't getting involved in the interscholastic sports, but that it did permit Fort Williams for the use of football for I call it the kids' team, the football club that has football. Secondly, this was all run by the Facilities 2000 Committee, and at the council workshop and looking at the various configuration of fields with I thought, an express direction to be sure to include one of the fields so that it would be adequate for football. It is in no way, you know, by buying the goalpost, it's no way taking a position whether or not the schools, the school sport ought to have football. It's a recognition that there are people in town who want to play football and that this is a field that they could use for that purpose.
I would just propose that item be removed from the list until we have an overall policy discussion and look at the actual cost of starting a football program in the town.
But you're willing to approve those dollars for the types of items, or do you wish to approve the dollars minus the cost of football posts, or do you want to just take the words "the football post"
I'd like to delete the words "the football goalposts" off the list.
Madam Chair, I respectfully disagree with Councillor Fritz. We have over 70 kids, over 60 plus kids. I don't know how many. Is that close? 60? 70? Something in that range of children over the last 2 years who have come out for football. The new public works facility and recreation complex is to, in my understanding, its goal is to address the needs of lack of fields that we currently have. I think if Sue Weatherby were here, she would tell you that we are really stretched for space. Whether anyone likes it or not, I think Cape football is here. It has had two very successful years. Next year, I fully anticipate with seeing the 7th graders move up to 8th grade and 8th grade move to 9th grade, that the junior club sport in high school will field a team. This year they didn't have enough, but after 2 years of a program that's underway, next year there will be enough kids to go forward to play football in the club sport in high school, I firmly believe. And this program has really come a long way. And I think that $2,600 in this budget of $166,000, I think would be short-sighted not to allocate that for football goalposts, because I think football is going to be here. It may not be to the same extent that we now see soccer, but it's not going to go away. This is a very much supported program by families in this community who have put forth a great deal of their own money to make sure that this program is successful. And we've seen it be very successful. So I think that we'd be misguided to strike this from the budget. And I, for one, if it's stricken from the budget, will not support this budget.
She's not striking the words, not the dollars.
Okay.
Okay. So any more? Well, we have a couple of things going on here. I think probably
there isn't a main motion yet.
There isn't a motion on the floor yet of any kind yet, so Councillor Fritz, if you would like to put that in as a motion, you'll have to do that we can then vote on. That you can either accept the report, accept the bid, minus that, or however you word your motion.
I will move that we accept the bid minus that item on the...
accepting the dollar amount minus the words.
Right. On the football goalposts taken out of the fixtures budget.
So does that mean that the money could not actively not be spent or does it just mean the words are gone?
I will move that it be removed until we have a policy discussion on whether or not to have a football program in the community.
The football program.
I see two different issues.
So I'm just delaying it.
I just see two different issues here. It's my understanding these are recreational fields. They're not necessarily having anything to do with the school system program of football or not football. I mean, there are kids who are interested in playing football who may not play on the school team, whether there is a team or not a team. But I think if we're providing support for passive recreation and trails and informal sports of just running around and, you know, kicking the ball around, and maybe some kids want to kick it through the goalposts or just do a little practice on weekends or something, I think we should support, it sounds sort of corny, but I think we should support kids who want to play football just as much as kids who want to play soccer and lacrosse. Just because soccer and lacrosse are really big in this town doesn't mean that kids who want to have some other alternative, that we can't throw in $2,600 for them.
Well, I think $2,600 is a small amount of money at this point. It's only for goalposts, but it leads to a what I think is a very expensive sports program. And I think
could I interrupt here for a minute, Councilor Fritz? We need to have a second for this motion. If there's going to be, if we're going to discuss this, we need to have a second for the motion that you have on the floor.
Could we repeat the motion? I want to make sure I understand.
I will move that we accept the bid of the Keeley Construction in the amount of, let me see, there's a total expense of $3,600,000. And that the fixtures budget delete the wording football goalposts for $2,600.
Okay. Is there a second to that motion?
I'll second that for purposes of discussion, but I'm opposed to doing that also. But I'll give you the second.
Well,
we have to vote.
Okay. All right, then we'll continue the discussion.
My point is that it moves closer to a program that we have not had a full evaluation of the budget amount for the program when we have other sports programs in the town that may not be fully funded, such as ice hockey, would serve children throughout a larger share of the year. So I think we need the policy discussion before we put equipment into this particular field situation.
Madam Chair.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Could I ask Ruth a question?
Yes, you could.
What do they use for goalposts now?
They don't have any. They use two of the orange cones, and they put them on both sides of the field, and they're currently playing on a field that is 10 yards short, 80 feet, not 100 feet. So, and they use the orange cones that they use to do drills for soccer.
I'd like to ask a student representative who would like to make a comment on this. Representative Bolas, is her speaker on?
Come use mine.
We'll find out.
Yeah.
I personally don't see the problem with allocating $2,600 for goalposts, and whether or not that leads to a program that might possibly be funded, I don't think that's really an issue. I think what we're looking at here is increasing the amount of play area we have for students at our school, and I have friends that play on the sports team, and I don't see why building two additional goalposts on our field is going to be a big deal. And even if it does lead to a policy that we need to, that the town needs to look at to fund that, I think that's a separate issue, and that when that time comes, then you can look at it, and then you can readdress it and see if you want to pay for that. But at this point, all it is two goalposts. I really don't see the conflict in that, but that's from my perspective.
That's very good. Thank you very much.
Madam Chair.
Councilor McGinty, who was there.
I just, usually probably said about me, but I just think it's ludicrous for us to be discussing $2,600 in a $3.6 million item, and I think we should move forward with this.
Madam Chairman, move the question. Yeah.
Thank you, Jack.
Right. You're the one who's
all those in favor of the motion? Yes. One. All those opposed? Six. The motion fails. I'll entertain a new motion, please. Counselor McGinty.
I move that we accept the bid, or the, is that right, the bid, Mike, is that right?
Yeah, to accept the bid, to authorize the manager to sign it, and to approve the budget of $3.6 million.
What he said.
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded. Discussion, please. Counselor Roberts.
Yes, Madam Chairman, I am going to vote for this, although I had some real severe reservations in doing so. Working for another government, I'm familiar with low bids, and I'm particularly concerned about low bids that are really low beyond the rest of the group. And this particular bid is $300,000 less than the nearest one, and the other four, there's only a $217,000 range between them. I've seen what can happen as when companies try to make up that difference when they bid that much lower than somebody else. However, after speaking with the town manager and with Mr. Oost, and having the assurance that there's an additional $40,000 going to be going into that for monitoring, I'm prepared to support it. I want to see the project go forward as much as anybody does. But I just want the contractor and everybody else to be put on notice that we will have that extra monitoring, and I hope that the council pays very close attention on a week-by-week basis as to what's happening over there to make sure we don't get shortchanged because we took the low bid.
Thank you. I don't know that the council is going to be over there standing over
there. We can be looking for reports and updates
but
from Mike.
You can authorize the manager to do that. I think that
I for one will be.
You need to authorize me. I'll do it anyway.
Yes, he's out on the limb here now. Councilor Berry.
To follow that one step further, do we have a performance bond in line here that will be strictly adhered to?
Yes, we have a performance bond, a labor and materials payment bond. Mm-hmm. We had a bid bond. We have insurance requirements, the full gamut.
And if they're late coming in, then they get penalized?
We don't, no, in this particular contract, we don't have liquidated damages for lateness. We've set it up so that they really have about a full year to do it, I think, wasn't it, under the contract? And, you know, the indication is it should be done at about 9 months, but it's not, there was no reason why we had to be in by a certain date that we wanted to put a liquidated damages clause in there and then have them budget something for that. We just didn't want to drive up the cost because that a liquidated damages clause can drive up the cost some because they put it in assuming that they might have to pay it. So we didn't put one in.
I think when it's a building that you have to be out of one space and into a new space, it's appropriate to have a liquidated damages, but because they can stay in there another day or two before they make the move, I think that I understand what the manager's saying about not wanting to drive up the price.
Then it's different from a swimming pool.
Right. They had to have a date specific to get into.
Madam Chair, I just wanted to have it noted that an earlier agenda item, we talked about the telecommunications tower, and I just want to be noted that in this budget of $3.6 million, we do not have any funds allocated in the event we were to authorize the building of a telecommunications tower at that facility. So if we were to go forward on one of those measures, we would have to fund that separately from this $3.6 million for this Goldcrest recreational fields.
That's correct.
We would have to fund it or find private, a joint public-private partnership.
Right.
Okay,
I just want to comment that I will support this because I, even though I objected to a small part of the budget, I mm-hmm. think this is a project that needs to move forward, and we have worked long and hard. And this whole Goldcrest property has such a good variety of both public works needs and fields, more fields for the kids and trails, and I think it's a great project.
Thank you. I'd like to caution Harvey Oost. I hope you plan for my two dogs to be able to walk out there someplace when you get that job done. I want those trails out there. I want Jack to cut them for me, too. I'd like to move the question. You know, we have a little levity back here in the council. I'd like to move the question. All those in favor? Opposed? Carries. Thank you very much. Consideration of proposed revisions to the fees for the use of Fort Williams Picnic Park shelter. Picnic shelter at the park. I could read these for just members of the public. They're not that long. This is a recommendation that comes from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission. Residents currently pay $40 to rent the picnic shelter. It's proposed that fee go to $75. Non-residents and groups currently pay $70 to rent the picnic shelter. It's proposed that the fee go to $150. And business and catered events that rent the shelter presently pay $150. It's proposed that that fee stay at $150. They are also making a recommendation that there's some fees for split times. Many times people rent the facility, but they only rent it for the morning. And because there's no time limit, it precludes us from renting it again in the afternoon. There is a fee structure for that for split days for $50 to take care of two different times of the days. And for outside residents, it would be $100. Those are the fees put before us. The council, please.
I move the adoption of the schedule. Second.
It's been moved and seconded that we adopt the schedule as proposed by the Fort Williams recommendation by the... Oh, it's really from Michael McGovern, isn't that right?
The top half's from the committee. The second half was from the staff meeting with the person who rents it, with Bob Malley and myself, and it was shared with the chairman of the committee over the phone, and we sent it to all the members of the committee, the bottom half.
Okay, fine. It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
Madam Chair, I have a couple questions. I tried to get some answers today, but I didn't make connections. The increase in fees from 40 to 75, 70 to 150, is there some precedent for or some reason why we're increasing them, you know, close to 50% plus, but we're not moving the price, current price, on the business and catered events?
One of the things I think to consider is the amount of time it takes for park people to set up and to clean up after these events.
Right.
And I think that probably a fee of $75 to cost for us to clean up empty trash and do all those things is probably a reasonable cost. Okay. Seems to me that $150 seems a pretty reasonable cost to cover the costs to clean up. I don't know if...
To answer your question specifically, it was decided to come up with a simpler... The committee recommended commission a simpler fee structure. If you're resident, $75. If you're not, it's $150. They really couldn't see the reason for the breakdown of non-residents and groups and business and catered events, because what we tried to have was more honesty and integrity in the system,
right,
because people would tell us one thing when in fact it was something else. So instead they decided to have just the two fees, and then we recommended half days at two-thirds of the regular fee.
Okay.
That's why that adds up to the 50 and the 100. And that's Karen Allen over Community Services is the person that you reserve the shelter with now, and she's just had to turn down so many groups, and particularly residents this past year. And you know, it was felt that we could try to divide it up by the day. And you know, we don't know if we'll take in more money, because in fact someone, we may not reserve it for the balance of the day, and someone would have ended up getting it for two-thirds the cost.
Right.
However, we think overall we will get a little bit more, and we definitely think that it'll make it more available to more people.
Okay. Thank you.
Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Consideration of a recommendation to set a public hearing for Monday, December 13th, 1999, on a proposed revision to the sewer rate schedule. This is I want you to know that this item was on my council 15 years ago, or in 1979 and 80. That's when this first.
Why didn't you take care of it then?
I don't know, we left it for you.
Yeah,
it was a problem for us, but it's more clear
around,
to me now.
Around. Now you got to deal with it again.
1967.
Can't believe I'm dealing with it again. I'll ask Michael to explain it, because it is a little.
This is a revenue neutral proposal. The total amount of revenues that would come into the sewer fund would be the same. However, right now the sewer rate structure is set up so that those in multi-unit structures pay on a per unit basis. What this change would do, if it was approved, is to change the billing so that it would be on a per meter basis. It is on a per meter basis in every other community that we're aware of. However, the effect of changing this, if you applied it and tried to get the revenue proportionally from both the minimum charge and from the incremental charge, the water usage charge, it in order to achieve savings to the multi-unit properties, property owners, you would need to increase everyone else's rates by 4.9% to both the minimum charge and the incremental charge. Sewer fees have not increased in Cape Elizabeth in about 9 years. So that, you know, it's not a substantial percentage when you look at it over the term of life. I think, you know, there is a policy issue for you to consider on whether or not you want to, you know, make that adjustment. The issue that I've had is I keep getting phone calls constantly from the multi-unit ones saying that they really don't feel they've had a chance for a hearing, that the council really hasn't dealt with it. When it came up during the budget process, they felt it got put off, saying, let's look at it before the budget process. The council, I think, was real clear in saying that you didn't want the general fund to subsidize the sewer fund, and that if you were to consider this, that it needed to be revenue neutral out of the sewer fund. You know, I think the best thing for you to do is, you know, not to say you're for or against this, is simply to have a public hearing and then to make a decision on whether or not you're for or against it. You know, I think it's something you definitely want to hear from the public. From the reverse side of the sheet shows that if you would put it all on the minimum rate, you could do that. If you put it all on the consumption rate, you could do that. The way it affects the multi-units is if you increase the per meter rate for everyone, they'll still be paying more on the per meter rate. They'll be paying the same rates as everyone else, only it'll be on the per meter rather than per unit. That was trying to answer the questions from your voicemail.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Councilor McGinty.
You indicate this will have some impact on the school.
Yes, it would. It would also decrease the sewer bill for the school department.
Would decrease or increase?
Would decrease the sewer bill for the school department.
Dr. McGinty.
Madam Chair, I move that we set this issue for a public hearing on December 13, 1999 at 7:30 p.m. at the town hall.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed?
And there will be an article in the Courier to explain the impact.
It's up to the Courier, the independent newspaper.
Yeah.
We'll try to get the word out, yes.
Item number 56, consideration of report providing for a strategic direction for the Cape Elizabeth Rescue Company. Any discussion? I don't know if I found this pretty interesting, this report about the rescue. Any comments you want to make before we refer to you?
I want to, Neil Allen, of the Executive Director of the Greater Portland Council of Governments, did this strategic direction with no billings to the town of Cape Elizabeth. This was all included within the COG dues, and I know a couple of years ago we put COG on notice of what were they doing for us, and I really appreciate Neil's personal time as well as professional time in putting this together. The rescue, I think, agonized over a lot of these issues. You know, there are some significant recommendations there in the report, but I think even where there are significant recommendations, there's words of caution. For example, recognizing that there may be different ways to compensate rescue members, compensation should be provided in a manner that is fair and equitable. And it's a matter of coming up with, you know, what is fair and equitable in dealing with that. The whole issue of how we interact with the city of South Portland, it encourages further discussion with them in terms of perhaps having a formal service agreement with the city to provide mutual aid for rescue beyond what we already have. Number 16, to ensure the financial stability of the rescue, a schedule for phasing in a reasonable fee for service should be developed. Lots of words that, yes, there's recommendations, but, you know, there's real soft comments in terms of how it's done. So what I'd like to do is to ask that you refer this back to me to come up with some recommendations that follow these findings and strategies for you to consider in the year 2000.
So moved.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? Councilor Barry?
Looking at number 8, as I read through my packet this weekend, while a small percentage of calls require a paramedic, the rescue currently has only one paramedic among its members, and consequently the rescue is generally not able to provide paramedic-level service without relying on South Portland, who, because of call volume, are not always able to respond And I would ask that the manager include some consideration for a paramedic for the town. I think that, I know I have had several calls from constituents suggesting a paramedic be made available for Cape Elizabeth, and I think Councilor Roberts has also had some similar contacts from constituents. And the comment was made that if someone was way down by Two Lights and you had to have a South Portland unit with a paramedic travel 5 or 6 miles to get there, that precious moments might be lost. And I think for the public safety issue, I would like to see that addressed as the manager is combing through these recommendations.
That's certainly a large item, because you're talking about coverage of hours and days of weeks and salaries and benefits and everything. So, yes, Councilor McGinty.
Who does the town manager intend to consult with in implementing this implementation strategy?
I intend to consult primarily with the chief, with the fire chief, and with the captain of the rescue. I've met with the captain. She said she might be here tonight. She didn't drop by. I intend to take all of these recommendations at face value. A lot of them do provide clear recommendations, and my recommendations will be totally in keeping with what's on these sheets of paper. I don't plan any variances from the sheet of paper. But I will consult with both the chief and with the captain of the rescue, but I won't go back to the rescue or to the Board of Fire Commissioners for every decision. I think they provided the strategic direction, and with a lot of discussion, a lot of debate, and I think it needs, and they've been doing it actually for several years. There was an earlier study, and I think it's time to really take what they've said and to try to come up with some concrete proposals. And it'll be very controversial. Once you get into the details of perhaps a fee structure, once you get into the details of compensation, and the question that Councilor Berry raised is really been a considered issue within the rescue unit as to whether or not we ought to be providing paramedic coverage or some of the level of coverage.
So
I go back to point four. Residents of the town expect to receive the best emergency care possible. It's how that all fits in. The implementation plan will not be easy to prepare.
For the benefit of the public, including myself, who might be somewhat vague on this, can you describe what paramedic coverage is versus other sorts of coverage?
I will try. Councilor McGinty is a member of the rescue and might have to fit in. There's several different levels of care. One is people that have no training at all, Good Samaritans. The next level is first responder, which is not much more than basic first aid. Beyond that, there is an emergency medical technician who can provide certain levels of care, can put on a defibrillator and those other types of talents. You then have advanced life support, which is the same thing as paramedic. No?
And yeah, three levels of emergency medical technician. You have basic, intermediate, and then paramedic at the top.
Yeah.
And each one has additional skills and training that they can provide.
Give certain drugs. Yeah. IVs, that type of thing.
Okay. Thank you.
Morphine, heroin, correct.
Do you intend to look at some other towns, and are there model rescue kind of ways these issues are dealt with? I mean, I'd like to have, along with the report, some background information.
I will, but my intent is to follow the strategic direction that has been set forth by the rescue, making my paramount concern, I'd say, number four, residents of the town expect to receive the best emergency care possible. And I think also equally important is to recognize their first finding is that the town of Cape Elizabeth is changing. Its population is both increasing and statistically growing older, and all of the ramifications of an aging population as we look at the rescue.
Madam Chairman.
Yes, Councilor Roberts.
Given, in light of the letter that a lot of us, perhaps all of us, received, Mr. Tommy?
Yes.
Tommy's.
And a number of other calls that I've gotten from other areas of the town, is it possible that the town manager could give us a date specific that he would give back his recommendations, or at least a target date, rather than just leaving it open to the year 2000? I'd like to see it moved along as quickly as possible.
March 1 would be fine.
Thank you.
Is there any more? There's a motion on the floor.
And I amend it to have the report back by March 1st.
Okay.
Second.
And the second? All right. All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Carries. Well, let me see here. Now, item number 57, consideration of the proposed creation of the Cape Elizabeth Playground Planning Committee. You saw in your packet the possible committee structure for this, that this is something that needs to be, as playgrounds are put up in various places all over the town and in various side lots of schools and buildings, and how that will impact on a long-term plan. It seems like a good time to put this committee forward. I will ask two counselors to participate in this committee, and the other organizations, the schools, et cetera, will appoint their own two people. I guess we're going to vote on the creation of this committee. Does everyone see the need for it? I didn't want to...
You know, I read the accompanying document that Mike gave us. Is there a serious... I almost first laughed when I saw that, because the charge came before the background information. And I said, you know, do we really need a playground study committee? We have so many study committees going. And I guess my concern is, I'm not opposed to this, certainly, but, I mean, is there a serious need that we take this up and look at it and you know, contribute a lot of our time, or at least a couple counselors' time, and other people to look at this?
I think it's important for council members to be involved because, you know, as my second bullet indicates, that, you know, parents have already begun to set aside monies. You know, it's a major priority with the parents, particularly at Pond Cove School. And as well as with some folks who live down near Fort Williams, it could have major cost implications. I said at the meeting that the superintendent of schools convened last week, you know, I said, like, we're talking $100,000, and they said, no, we're talking $300,000. And when I heard that, I thought there ought to be at least two council members on the committee.
Madam Chair,
deal with it.
Yeah. I'm kind of surprised with your numbers, because to answer your question, Councilor McGinty, I've been approached by several people about the need for the playground, that we have equipment that's unsafe. In fact, some of it has been taken down. And I know that several of these groups have on their own accumulated monies of $5,000 to $6,000. You know, so they're pretty serious. I mean, that's pretty serious money for these parents' associations. And at one point, I had heard a figure of $30,000 to $40,000 bandied around. And now you mentioned 100, and they say 300. So I guess the problem is growing as we speak.
Councilor McGinty.
I guess one of my questions is, most of these playgrounds are on school property, and these are parent associations of kids in school, obviously. Maybe should the school board be dealing with this rather than the town council?
I think maybe in terms of cost, they will if they're on the school grounds, although we have participated in the past in the cost of some play facilities, including Fort Williams. I think the idea is not just the safety, which is, of course, the number one importance, but it's also planning ahead. You can't have 20 parents coming to you and say, guess what, this is where we want to put our playground.
But that's a school issue. Yeah. I mean, I can see the Fort Williams issue, but most of the other playgrounds, I believe, are on school property.
Yeah, we have taken responsibility for the school grounds. We're responsible for the roads now. We're responsible for the lawns. We're responsible for the tennis courts. We're responsible for the ball fields.
You're right.
And, you know, we're responsible for the playgrounds.
Councilor McGinty, if I may, many people would argue with you that the school, although they're on the school grounds, that they really are a municipal facility, because preschools use them. Many people on Saturdays and Sundays within the community.
Oh, I've used them. I mean, this.
Yeah, so,
sure.
So I think that it's, you know, as Penny was just saying, it's kind of that one town concept. We have to share all of these facilities. So
just a question. So.
But I do think it warrants having someone take a real close look at the amount of money we're spending and you know, scrutinize it fairly closely for long-term objectives.
And I think that's an important reason that it'd be good to have some council people.
There should be council representatives, and as I say, there is the safety, there is the cost, but it's also looking ahead on where predictably you might be able to put some, or have a need to put playground equipment, rather than just suddenly having it sprout up without as much thought as necessary. Did somebody move the question?
Do we have a motion?
Yeah, we need a motion.
I'd like to move that we approve creation of the Cape Elizabeth Playground Planning Committee.
As drafted.
And it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion?
Is playscape really a word?
Playscape is a word, like streetscape and...
landscape.
I've just spent, you know, a whole year on a streetscape committee, so... And the report is about 3 inches thick. All those in favor? Opposed? None. The motion carries. Item number 58, consideration of request from the New England Telephone and Telegraph Company for a pole location on Windmill Lane. Windmill Lane is at Bothell's, where the windmill actually is. And I suppose the appropriate question is the pole in place already?
I drove by there earlier today in the best remembrances of Councillor Billy Jordan, and the pole is not there.
It was almost, you know, in my earlier years, it was almost always in place before we voted. Any further? Well, I'll take a motion.
I'll make a motion that they be authorized to stick up the pole.
He's going to build a home on that lot. He needs the access.
Elegantly pole. Put, Henry.
Second?
Second.
You want to second those words?
I don't know. I wouldn't if I were you.
We'll let the minutes reflect it.
I didn't. Correct
criminal. All those in favor?
Oh, jeez.
How flowery have you be to stick up a telephone pole?
Consideration, item number 59, consideration of a recommendation from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission recommending the use of the Fort Williams Park for the annual MS Society Walk scheduled April 9th in the year 2000. This is, they've had this several times, yes?
Yeah, this has been approved every year. It was dated September 20th, it was in my council pending file. I put it on the agenda, and after I did, Bob Malley informed me that for scheduling reasons, the Fort Williams Advisory Commission had, in fact, not reviewed it. I assumed that it had been reviewed and approved, but they have not, in fact, reviewed this request.
They have not?
No.
This one?
I was in my files, so I assumed they had, but it had.
Councilor McGinty.
I move that we table this issue until we can receive a report back from the Fort Williams Advisory Commission.
I think that'll probably
second.
Be an agreement. All those in favor? Opposed? There being no discussion on the tabling. are there any citizens who would like to make a discussion of items not on the agenda? They're hearing none. I'll entertain a motion for dismissal.
One quick thing. It's not on the agenda, but for purposes of the minutes. We received the bond proceeds from the bond, and some of those bond proceeds will be placed in CDs CDs through Tucker Anthony. They were the best rates we were able to obtain. We went through different bids. We have an existing account there, but for audit purposes, and we don't need a council authorization, but just for audit purposes, the minutes could reflect that we're investing funds there. It creates the audit trail. So make sure that they look at that.
All right.
Move for dismissal. Second.
All those in favor? Thank you.
Thank you.
We are adjourned.